fairly informal. I don't really have a lecture to give you, although being a college professor, that's always, you know, we're sort of on automatic pilot. As soon as we start talking, we stop. So if I begin to lecture, you'll just have to bear with me. But you can also ask questions at any time. Just raise your hand. I'm going to ask you a few questions, too. I'm teaching a seminar this fall. It's a special interdisciplinary seminar that's sponsored by the Humanities Institute, the Frankie Institute. We have a special classroom over in the library in Regenstein, a very wired classroom. And the subject of it is race, media, and visual culture. The basic idea of the Frankie program is to allow team teaching between colleagues who have areas of expertise that would make an interesting synthesis. So I'm team teaching this with my colleague Darby English in the artistry department. Darby English has recently published a book on recent African American artists. It's called How to See a Work of Art in Total Darkness. And if you're wandering around campus today, you get to the seminary co-op, I recommend it highly. I think it's the best book on contemporary black art in America that we have. My special interests are in media and visual culture. And Darby and I have been talking for some time about doing a course together that would bring together mass culture, media, and the visual arts around the question of race. And it's partly seemed to anyone in this room, I'm sure, has been vividly aware that race has reemerged as an important topic in American culture, and for that matter, global culture. In the last couple of years, we are it's an experimental course. It's much more broad ranging than the usual course in African American studies or seminars, courses that deal with more specialized or particularized or localized forms of racial difference, racialization, and racism. Basically, the course is attempting to triangulate three areas of racial prejudice. The first, and without question, the most famous and the most virulent in the 20th century is anti-Semitism. And to study that topic, we went back to the great classic text on anti-Semitism written by the French philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre. Immediately in the aftermath of World War II, somewhat before the facts of the Holocaust had become fully known, Sartre decided to write a short polemical book. It's called Anti-Semitism and the Jew. And if you've never read it, it's a short book. It's a real classic. We spent two full seminar sessions just discussing the intricacies of this book, because in some ways it is the foundation for all modern critiques of racism. Immediately, writers like Frantz Fanon in the Caribbean, writers in America dealing with negrophobia, negritude, and anti-black prejudice, they built upon Sartre's insights. And the book is very much relevant today, not only as a critique of anti-Semitism, but as something that takes us well beyond anti-Semitism to the general character of race prejudice, of racism. Sartre's basic argument, first let me just say, so we're triangulating the question of anti-Semitism with negrophobia, with the African Americans, primarily in the United States, but not exclusively. And then the third form prejudice we're talking about is Islamophobia, the prejudice against the Arab world. We see all three of these as not only analogous, involving stereotyping, caricaturing of whole social groups, ethnicities, nations, types of people, but also deeply connected. Franz Fanon, for instance, took Sartre's insights and in books like Black Skin, White Masks, he elaborated the whole relationship between anti-Semitism and necrophobia. And then he carried that on in his book, Notes on a Dying Colonialism, to the analysis of Algeria and Algeria's relation to France. So there the issue was not so much black and white as European and Arab. And so one of the big problems of the course that we're dealing with is the relation between the general and the particular. The general structure of racism as a kind of toxic relationship that, on the one hand, as Sartre puts it, that racism is not an idea, it's a passion. It's a conviction which becomes, which eats away at the inside of an individual until they become a kind of vessel for hatred and fear. So it's, you can't study racism without doing both psychology and sociology. And, of course, the place where psychology and sociology meet is the humanities, the study of culture, the realm of symbols, narratives, images. That's where the work of Darby English and myself comes in. So I was trying to think about how we could possibly convey what's going on in this seminar in 1 hour here and give you some time to ask questions. What we began with, I thought we'll just begin the way we began the seminar back in late September. And that's to focus on first on the most immediate and famous case in our time of a kind of momentous historical event that seems important in whatever history of race relations might ever be written about the United States. And that's, of course, the election of Barack Obama. So I want to, I have a few clips and images in here to show you. There, of course, is first this icon, the icon of Barack Obama as a figure, what sometimes called the post-racial society. As you know, Obama has anything but a simple relationship to the question of race. He consistently is asking people not to talk about it. He wants to de-emphasize it. He wants to be president of all ethnic groups in the United States and not seen as just a black president. And in that, he's, I think, typical of all the artists that Darby English is studying. Very few of them want to be labeled as black artists. They want to be known as artists who happen to be black. So there is a strong feeling that Obama's election, if there was ever a signal that the race problem in the U.S. is undergoing, if not a conclusion, at least some kind of important transformation, then Obama's election would be that. At least it's certainly at the level of imagination and speculation indicates an important historical turning point. I personally do not believe it means that the question of race is behind us. I don't think we live in a post-racial world or society. But at the same time, images sometimes predict a future. They urge us on toward a future. They express possibility and hope. And I think that's basically what Obama's election did. As a question of method, then, I might say, since we are humanists, Professor English and myself, we're not doing sociology. We're not so interested in statistics about poverty, violence, discrimination, powerlessness.
although those certainly are the foundational issues in the real world, we're more interested in media, visual culture, and the way that, that race is configured by various forms of representation, whether it's literature, art, television, political propaganda, whatever. So Obama has provided what we think of as a kind of moment of transformation or hope. Let me then pose to you some of the questions that we've been raising in this class. The first one is simply, how important is race today? Has it declined in significance? I mean, a long time ago, my former colleague, William Julius Wilson, wrote a book called The Declining Significance of Race. And more recently, scholars like Walter Michaels at University of Illinois written a book called The Trouble with Diversity, arguing that really race is not so important anymore, that the problem is capitalism. So you get a kind of convergence on the right and the left. On the right, people say, yes, race is not important anymore because now we live in a country where everyone's free to compete, and so stop whining about race, get out there and compete. On the left, they say, we live in a world where race is not the issue, money is the problem, and some people don't have any of it. So capitalism is the real issue. Our view is that race is still crucial, but it's also related to lots of other questions, like, and this is a kind of second big question in the course, how does race intersect with other forms of social difference? With, for instance, gender, or class, or national identity, ethnicity, language, sexual orientation. Race is simply one among a whole series of social differences that involve prejudice, discrimination, fear and hatred, and consequences for poverty and powerlessness on the part of the minority discriminated against. A conceptual question we've been pondering is, what is the relation between race and racism? It's a funny kind of question, I know, because it seems like it should be obvious. It's like the relation between ideals and idealism, or matter and materialism. But on the other hand, maybe not. It's occurred to us to think of race as not the radical origin, the concept, but racism itself, which has been around since time immemorial. The concept of race is relatively modern, and it developed historically as a way of explaining and often justifying racism. Not always, it didn't always go to justify. In fact, a lot of race theory was aimed at overturning racism. So the relation of these two concepts might be thought of as something like the relation of a diagnosis to a disease. That is, race is the diagnosis, racism is the disease, or the pathology and the cure, the diagnostic instrument. And a final question that has been plaguing us throughout is the question of how we know what race is. Is race teachable? This is Darby English's question, and I think it's a very profound and disturbing one. Because, as you can imagine, this is an extremely difficult, intractable, and emotional topic for many people. You often feel like you're walking on eggs talking about it. It's easy to go astray. So one of our big challenges has been to create a safe classroom environment in which people are free to speak without feeling like they have to be paranoid or that they have to speak for everyone in whatever social group they stand for. Myself, this means that I do not speak for all Irishmen, even though I have the snubby little nose and blue eyes and lack of hair that goes with being Irish. It's especially difficult to teach about race because, and racism particularly, because the concept is so ambiguous. On the one hand, it's most modern cultural studies people, anthropologists, ethnographers, and social scientists say race is nothing but a cultural construction. This is now the mantra throughout academia. If you walk into any college classroom, you will hear that phrase. Race is nothing but a cultural construction. Unfortunately, when you walk then out of the classroom and onto the street, turns out race comes back as something more than merely a cultural construction. My old friend Henry Louis Gates, who I'll talk about more in a minute, once said, yeah, race is a perfectly safe subject in my classroom at Harvard, but to try to catch a taxi in Harlem at 10 o'clock at night, and then you find out that the cultural construction has teeth that you did not anticipate. There's another problem with what's called the race card, which is constantly, people are being accused of playing the race card or using code words, crime, violence, poverty, when they really want to talk about race. And the minute then that anybody says, oh, you're talking about race, or even worse, you are a racist, then the denials and the disavowals come. So it's a subject which it's very hard to pin down. Racism is both a passion and something that has historically been justified by biological science, a lot of pseudoscience, and we have to admit that there is a biological element to it. Although Gates's studies in genetics and genealogy suggest that when people begin to study their own DNA, what they're really interested in is not the genetics, but the genealogy. They want to know who their great-grandfather and grandmother were. So it's much more a question of the continuity of a family than it is of continuity of genetic codes. So the concept of race is radically ambiguous. It's a subject of both rationality and irrational prejudice, of emotion and science. It's a matter of both subjective and objective factors. And that's why we felt it important not to do some kind of one-sided or narrowly specialized account of this, since this is a topic that has come up in our time in a new way. It's time to rethink it and not just take for granted that we already know what race is. And fortunately, we have a superb group of students from all over the university who are making the discussions lively, and I learn something new every day. A couple seats right here. So let me begin then with the question of teachability. And as you saw, the theme for this, the place we started with the seminar was with this idea of teachable moments. I'm sure you all know where we got that title. Maybe I'll go to that first and just remind you of this moment in recent history.
My hope is that as a consequence of this event, this ends up being what's called a teachable moment, where all of us, instead of pumping up the volume, spend a little more time listening to each other and try to focus on how we can generally improve relations between police officers and minority communities, and that instead of flinging accusations, we can all be a little more reflective in terms of what we can do to contribute to more unity Lord knows we need it right now, because over the last 2 days, as we discussed this issue, I don't know if you've noticed, but nobody's been paying much attention to healthcare. I will not use this time to spend more words on healthcare, although I can't guarantee that that will be true next week. But I just wanted to emphasize that one last point I guess I'd make. So there are some who say that as president, I shouldn't have stepped into this at all because it's a local issue. I have to tell you that that part of it I disagree with. The fact that this has become such a big issue, I think, is indicative of the fact that race is still a troubling aspect of our society. Whether I were black or white, I think that me commenting on this and hopefully contributing to constructive as opposed to negative understandings about the issue is part of my portfolio. So at the end of the conversation, there was discussion about my conversation with Sergeant Crawley. There was discussion about he and I and Professor Gates having a beer here in the White House. We don't know if that's scheduled yet, but.
Okay, so, and you all know, I'm sure, what Obama was responding to. The arrest of Harvard professor Henry Louis Gates, one of the most prominent black intellectuals in America, had frequent appearances on PBS and the History Channel. A very eminent scholar, was returning from a lecture tour in China and had just come home to find his door jammed at his Cambridge house. A neighbor called and said somebody appeared to be trying to break in. But if you study the police calls and the transcript, as I did, you'll see that she doesn't say they were black people. In fact, the police keep asking, are they black? What race are these people? The eyewitness on the scene said, I don't know. I have no idea what race they are. Can't tell. It's just happening down the street. The police arrived, and from the time of their arrival to 6 minutes later, Henry Louis Gates was led away in handcuffs. I'll come back to these images in a minute, but it suggests that it seems that there's very little doubt there was racial profiling going on here. There's some dispute about whether Professor Gates was behaving in an angry fashion, whether he was telling the police officer, this is my house, and perhaps with a few choice epithets. But the fact is he was led away under arrest 5 minutes later. The charges, of course, of disorderly conduct were dropped almost immediately. But I want to take Obama's concept of the teachable moment, the moment when race erupts in our consciousness through mass media, visual culture, and becomes an issue that, that people care about. And I want to go back to Obama's own election. And raise the question of what role race played prior to the election and after it. One thing I think has perhaps is perhaps forgotten now since the election is a fact, but that about a year ago this time, it was still up for grabs. Nobody knew how it was going to come out, and in fact, if it hadn't been for the economic crisis, it's not altogether clear that Obama would have been elected. You all may remember that the Republican Party had received a great jolt of energy from the redoubtable Sarah Palin, who had brought their polls up for a considerable amount of time. So, and then there was, aside from Obama's color, his race, there was his name,
which he himself reflected on. And he talked about himself as a skinny guy with big ears and a college professor to boot, emphasizing how incredibly improbable, how long the odds were against his being elected. And perhaps most important, a name. There's the sound of Obama's name, which, if you think with your ears, is an echo of the two great arch enemies of the U.S. during the preceding 8 years. That is Osama bin Laden and Saddam Hussein. And believe me, the echoes of those names were used again and again during the election cycle, so that Obama was associated with everything from Muslim radicalism to black militancy, and his name, of course, helped to echo that with its Arabic overtones. Immediately after his election, we knew that we were not in a post-racial period when we began to get images like this circulating on the internet. Or images like this of the White House with its watermelon patch. Or a new variation on the old vaudeville routine of whiteface. This is the most recent slander. As you know, there are people out there called the birthers who argue that Obama was actually born in Africa and that an elaborate fraud was perpetrated some 48 years ago, 49 years ago, to make it seem like he was a native-born American citizen, because they knew that eventually he would be moving into the White House, even at his birth. And all this was summarized in a wonderful little video clip on Bill Maher on HBO a couple of months ago, especially when the there was a kind of convergence between the Tea Party folks and the birthers in this. Obama's election had the effect of taking a kind of racial innuendo and racial slurs and caricatures that had been somewhat underground, understated during the election campaign, and bring them out into the open. It's as if, rather than introducing a post-racial era, he brought his election brought back a revival of the most virulent stereotypes. And this New Yorker cover from a year ago last summer was an attempt to actually expose this before the fact. The New Yorker basically exposed the view of Obama that was being circulated on Fox News and the conservative blogosphere. The Obamas here portrayed Michelle as an Angela Davis type revolutionary, a Black Panther, and Obama himself as a Muslim militant. You may all recall that moment in John McCain's campaign when a woman came up and said, well, he's a Muslim, isn't he? And McCain had to say, no, he's not a Muslim, he's a very nice man. He has a wife and kids, and he's really okay. Not a Muslim.
There's no way that fits my
So a lot of my friends on the left were very unhappy with this New Yorker cover. They felt like it was just loading the gun of racism, Islamophobia, against the Obamas. My own view was that it was the pictorial equivalent of inoculation. That is, a measured dose of the toxin that was circulating in the media sphere, on Fox News and the blogosphere, and exposing the ludicrousness of these stereotypes, making them visible so that the innuendo would be recognized for what it was. But honorable people can disagree about whether it was a good thing or a bad thing. If Obama had lost the election, I probably would have been very angry with the New Yorker, but thank God. it didn't turn out. And so the humor of the New Yorker turns out in retrospect to have been just the right medicine. This level, after Obama's election, of racial caricaturing, I think, crossed the line. This was the New York Post, Rupert Murdoch's newspaper. You may recall it was based on an incident in New York City where a chimpanzee attacked a person and was shot by the police. Nothing there particularly for political satire or cartooning, you would think. But Murdoch's paper managed to make the link by putting it together with the writer of the stimulus bill. Now, of course, it doesn't take rocket science to figure out who they mean by that. This is almost a direct call for assassination. And as you know, people have been showing up with racist placards, carrying automatic weapons at Obama rallies, saying that they're not there to create trouble, they just want to express their right to free speech and their right to bear arms in public. Raises perhaps the most extreme kind of moment in race hatred, racial prejudice, when the other, the subject of racism, is seen not as another kind of human being, a stranger, an alien, but as another species. And in fact, during the 19th century, in the long disgraceful history of racism, I'm sorry to say that many scientists actually underwrote this notion that black people, Asians, and Jews were so different as to be members of a different species. And this is why the question of sexuality becomes so important, because miscegenation, the mixing of racial heritage, hybridity, all of those things become, in the view of the racist, who always has a notion of purity in mind, these become abominations. You can see why Obama, as probably the most famous mixed-race person on the planet, a very light-skinned African-American, plays the role of a kind of abomination to the racists. I want to come back now to the arrest of Henry Louis Gates. The still photograph shows him at the moment when he was being led from his house in handcuffs. Now, a lot of people attacked Obama when he said, and I quote, "Even though I wasn't there, it is clear to me that the Cambridge police acted stupidly." The question is, how could it be clear to someone who wasn't there? How do we know what Henry Louis Gates was saying? Perhaps he said, fuck you, or get out of my house, or something else. We don't know what he said. Actually, it turns out there is not an eyewitness, but an ear witness to what he said, because Skip Gates was on his cell phone at the moment the cop arrived, was talking to the Harvard Property Management Corporation and asking them to send somebody to fix his door. So The woman at Harvard Property Management heard every word that went on. Turns out that Gates did not curse out the cop. He simply challenged the cop and said, "I want to see your identification. Who are you?" He did not engage in disorderly conduct. Nevertheless, he was arrested. The reason his mouth is open here, I think, is not because he's screaming epithets, but because he is saying, "I need my cane." Skip Gates has walked with a cane for the last 20 years because of numerous hip operations. So his arrest, in my view, was an outrage. It took 5 minutes from the time the police arrived to this photograph being taken and led away. The arresting officer refused to apologize, and despite the fact that the Cambridge Police Department immediately dropped the charges. The only charge, and I want to read a little bit from Bob Herbert's editorial, because if you may recall, almost everyone took what I would call, and what Jean-Paul Sartre called, the liberal democratic view on this, which is, we don't know what went on. Probably two good people getting angry at one another. Let's just all calm down. Why can't we just all get along? And that was actually the role that Barack Obama played. Two good people, just a misunderstanding. Here's Bob Herbert in the New York Times. If Professor Gates ranted and raved at the cop who entered his home uninvited with a badge, a gun, and an attitude, he didn't rant and rave for long. The 9/11 call came in at 12:45 on the afternoon of July 16th, and as the Times has reported, Mr. Gates was arrested, cuffed, and about to be let off by 12:51, 6 minutes. The charge, angry while black.
Contempt of cop.
The President of the United States has suggested that we use this flare-up as a teachable moment, but so far, exactly the wrong lessons are being drawn from it, especially for black people. The message that has gone out to the public is that powerful African-American leaders like Mr. Gates and President Obama will be very publicly slapped down for speaking up and speaking out about police misbehavior, and that the proper response, if you think you are being unfairly targeted by the police because of your race, is to chill, be quiet. Herbert goes on to remind us that actually we do have a right to free speech in this country, and saying disrespectful words to an officer, even accusing him of racism, when you are standing in your own house with your identification, that is not a crime. And of course, the Cambridge police did drop the charges. So you don't actually have to have been there to see what was happening here. It was a classic case of racial profiling. Unfortunately, it looks like Officer Crowley doesn't watch the PBS or the History Channel, or he would have recognized Professor Gates right away. So a teachable moment. What lesson do we learn from this? Well, one lesson I think a lot of black people already know is, and white folks, I've learned also, when a police officer decides to give you a hard time, don't say a word. Be really, really nice. Now, is that the lesson that a free country or democracy should be inculcating? That the police are in charge everywhere? No matter what the conditions. That's one lesson. Another lesson, and Jean-Paul Sartre predicted this sort of thing, is that you can be a cop in this country, arrest somebody wrongfully in their own house, drag them down to the station in handcuffs, and be rewarded with an invitation to the White House, if it can be cast as a story of two nice people getting into an argument. So what kind of lessons do we learn from this? I would say the lessons are not quite the ones
that Barack Obama wanted to draw from it. I understand why he did it, because he wanted to calm down political passions. As Sartre put it very well, the problem with the liberal democratic even-handedness about racial confrontation is that it always says, give equal time to the racist. And since the racist is always shouting louder, they demand the stage. That's what led to the Beer Summit, the shouting of people that this is reverse racism, this is a personal matter the president is inflating into a cause. The Beer Summit went on, it was fairly ridiculous. Nobody heard what happened. All we know is what brand of beer they drank. But there is also, I think, a third lesson we might learn, and that's perhaps there is a little bit of progress in the fact that the charges were dropped. As far as we know, Gates was handcuffed with considerable discomfort, but that is really about the worst thing that happened to him. For another moment, another teachable moment, I want to go back to a moment of race relations in America that I imagine many of you will remember. This comes from 1991, and you can see the exact time of day. That's Rodney King, as you remember, in Los Angeles. This is an arrest for speeding on an L.A. freeway, in which Rodney King was accused of resisting arrest. And as you may recall, the denouement of this, this was an amateur video, somebody passing by who just happened to capture this. Of course, every black person knows this is a routine occurrence, but very rarely videotaped. Like the recent murder of a student here on the South Side at a predominantly black school, these things usually don't make it onto the media. So is this a teachable moment as well? I think it has to be added, and we need to ask what lesson is to be drawn from it. Here's the lesson that the jury drew from it. As you know, the police were put on trial.
Why did the jury see the beating of Rodney King in such a vastly different light? Here's ABC's Judy Mock.
It was never even close. On the very first day of deliberations, a straw vote made it clear that a majority of the jurors favored acquittal. How could that be, given the powerful evidence of the videotape? Two jurors talked to ABC News today by phone.
Everybody's saying this videotape, but these officers have a job to do, and in doing that job, they have to be given a certain amount of reasonable, and that's what this is, you know, reasonable force.
The defense attorneys were really slick, and they undermined all the evidence that was brought forth by the prosecuting attorneys.
Several jurors say they were persuaded by the defense argument that the videotape did not tell the whole story, and that Rodney King represented a threat to the officers.
They didn't know what they had to take. A man that's over 230 pounds, and you put him on the ground, and four officers go in to put handcuffs on him, and he throws those officers off.
The jurors were convinced that it was King who controlled the action, that he could have stopped the beating by surrendering. The officers, they felt, used reasonable force, with the possible exception of one.
I believe Powell was out of control.
That juror was one of four who voted to convict Powell of excessive use of force, a split that resulted in a mistrial on that count. The jury was made up of 10 whites, one Hispanic, and one Asian. Critics of the verdict are questioning whether this jury of their peers gave the white defendants an edge, and whether King's race was a factor.
It didn't make any difference to me, and I don't think it made any difference to the majority of the jury.
And how do they feel about the violent reaction to their verdict?
Even looking at this after the fact, and I'm very sorry that this happened, but it wouldn't change how I voted.
What human being would be influenced by this? You know, this is ridiculous. This is chaos right now, and I can't help but feel somewhat responsible.
And yet, he says, if he had to do it again, he would vote the same way. Judy Mo.
You may all recall then that during the L.A. riots that followed the beating of Rodney King and the acquittal of the police, he came on television to urge calm. And he said the memorable words, why can't we all just get along? I think the question of teaching race in America or teaching race in any part of the world comes down to not an answer, but a question. The question Rodney King answered, and in a way Barack Obama was urging people to just get along, but I think he was also asking, why can't we? What is it about race that makes it keep coming back in new and more virulent forms? What is it about our species that seems to require us to project some kind of social other, to classify others, and to treat them as inherently, by birth, the enemies of all of our interests? I want to conclude then with one final video. Get this out of the way. This is a scene from an Israeli film by Yaev Shamir, made in 2003. It's a documentary film of about an hour and 20 minutes. It's called Checkpoint. And it is a fly-on-the-wall documentary in which the Israeli filmmakers were able to visit just about all of the several hundred checkpoints that are dotted all over the countryside, the West Bank. As you probably are aware, the West Bank has been under military occupation for quite a long time, and one of the consequences of that is any movement on the part of Palestinians involves going through either permanent checkpoints in between towns or what are called flying checkpoints that can appear unpredictable. So to get to school, to get to your job, to get to your relatives, get to a doctor, is a daily ordeal that the Palestinians have lived with for quite a long time. Many Israelis are extremely unhappy with this situation, as you know. They live in a country now, Greater Israel, Eretz Israel, as it's sometimes called, is 50% Palestinian, 50% Arab. So you have to imagine a country in which half of the population is under military occupation year-round, all the time. It's not like a war that comes to an end. It's simply an ongoing occupation. So this is simply one 30-second moment in a documentary. And I want to emphasize this is an Israeli documentary. This is not propaganda from the Palestinian side. It is part of, I think, a very pervasive and growing sense of criticism inside Israel of its own military regime and the way it treats the Palestinians, particularly when you see the kind of nice young man you're going to see in this video clip talking about his attitude toward the Palestinians.
הבעיה שהחיות עכשיו סגורות שם, לא בסדר. מה? לא, אנחנו בני אדם, הם חיות. להם אין צלם אנוש, לנו יש. זה ההבדל בין...
בולה, בולה!
מה?
תצלם, אכפת לי אליך, שכן, אני שמי לך. תגידי גם הרמטכ"ל יהיה.
Another documentary I saw, I went to a film festival, was invited to reflect on recent Israeli documentary films 2 years ago at a festival in Tel Aviv. And one of the other films was by a woman director who was interviewing families that are considering emigrating, that is Jewish families considering coming back to the U.S. And the pervasive theme of this film was the question, well, why? Why are you doing it? Why are you abandoning Israel? The answer again and again was, because my children are approaching military age. One father said, I would not have a problem with my children growing up and having to fight to defend our country, and even to die for it, because I love this country. What I do not want is for my children to be turned into fascists. And that's what happens when they engage in the work of this occupation. The film Checkpoint gives you a window into what you might call on the other side of the thin blue line, the police point of view, the border police in this case. So what are the teachable moments? I mean, it can be a very depressing subject, obviously, one that doesn't lead to very clear resolution, but I think does raise an ongoing question which we can't ever let go of, and that is, why can't we get along? What is it that would be required to get along? A beer summit? Probably not enough. But social justice, economic justice, a police force that is disciplined. I'm sad to say that Sergeant Crowley, the Cambridge police officer, who arrested Henry Louis Gates, is in charge of his department's seminars on race relations. He's the one who is supposed to explain the proper conduct when you're dealing with black people or other non-white persons. So we have a lot to learn, and this seminar for me is an opportunity to begin doing that. I'd be happy to take questions or comments that any of you have. Yes.
I'm not quite sure how to put it, but it's something along the lines of, I'm wondering if we aren't in an epoch historically where, because we're confronting more changes in our ideas about race, certain facts are in our face more for some of us, I mean, depending on who we are and what our backgrounds are, that many of us as a big community internationally are a little more raw, and as a result are abandoning or losing our ability to have appropriate discourse about it, so that even in a situation, people might feel, as you talk about these topics, more licensed to interrupt you, or certainly in bigger gatherings. And I can think of when Prime Minister Olmert was here, or I was at the San Francisco Jewish Film Festival this past summer when there was a series of difficult, 600-person discussions. And I'm thinking, well, I don't really want to know that we all have to go through a TSA-type inspection just to get into an auditorium to listen. But I'm wondering, what are these teachable moments, and is there a way in which we can be extra thoughtful about how to have thoughtful dialogue? And you think about these things so well and so much that, do you have thoughts, or?
Well, I do think it's important that we have not only teachable moments where things come to our attention, but that we think about the protocols of teaching. I personally was quite upset that, that some of my colleagues and some of the students here chose to prevent Olmert from speaking. If they had listened, they would have found that Olmert, forget about whatever he's done in the past, is now calling for a complete withdrawal from the West Bank and the establishment of an independent Palestinian state. He's his position is almost indistinguishable from that of Jimmy Carter, who I think of as, you know, one of the great peacemakers of our time. And I hope Obama will be, now that he's got the prize. and, you know, even though I was perhaps a little sarcastic about Obama's role in this, that, you know, I don't think that police officer deserved to get invited to the White House for his behavior. He could have at least repaid it with an apology, an acknowledgement that he did act stupidly. Obama got it right the first time. Nevertheless, when Obama says, people have said this is a local issue, I shouldn't intervene, he said, no, I disagree with that. It's part of my job, my portfolio. When we brought up the question of the teachable moment in our seminar, several of the students are themselves teachers, social workers, people from all over the campus. And one of them said, Professor Mitchell, do you know where the phrase teachable moment comes from? No, I just, you know, Obama made it up. He said, no, he said, this is what we call a teachable moment. It's something that community organizers use and elementary school teachers use when they, and it's about teaching kids to go to the bathroom or teaching people to raise their hand. It's about proper moral conduct. It requires, of course, a benign, all-knowing teacher who knows what the right thing is and a compliant group of students who are ready to be taught. So it's a little bit of a patriarchal atmosphere. And Obama was saying, yeah, I'm the president, I'm the patriarch, so I have to play this role and try to make something educational out of it. To that I say, yeah, okay, I'm on your side there. Yes?
Yes, I like what you just used, the word patriarch, and I noticed that you never used the word white male. You did talk about gender once, but I'm wondering if you look at this a little bit differently, and you look at it also from the Sartre point of view, that there's always an other, and the people who are in charge, at this moment it happens to be white heterosexual males, mostly, and in other countries it's also usually male, but they may not be white, etc. So if you look at more than just the race, but also the gender, and who is doing the looking. In your case, as you said, you are Irish, although you didn't give all the stereotypes. I must say you forgot a few of them. I don't want to add them.
I don't want to think about that.
Yeah, okay. What I'm saying is you also concentrate, which most of the people here I'm sure do, on non-papers, not newspapers. And I happen to concentrate on newspapers. If you also put a little section on in newspapers, you will see that not only is race emphasized, but anything that the person who's taking the picture, who it's the other, and they want to, if they're doing a picture of, say, female black females, she usually has her bust in the view. Or almost any female is in a very uncomplimentary light. If they're doing Muslims, it's always people who look Muslim. If they're doing Jews, it's always men with long beards and hats. There are plenty of Jews that don't look like that. In fact, the ones with the hats and the beards are really the minority, which brings me to the point of this. You can show this, and he's one guy, but if you look on any of the Palestinian or the other, some of the other Arab newspapers and TVs and videos, you will see the most hate, not only towards Jews, but to anybody who isn't following their particular brand of Islam, whether it's between Hamas and the PA, or it's between Chinese and the people who are against the any free speech there, or it's against anybody who disagrees with them. They will have little kids on their TV saying how many Jews their mother killed when she was a suicide bomber, and there are little camps where they play with their guns and things.
There's no doubt about it.
So you can't just show
one
guy who, for all we know, is, you know, a crackpot, and not, you know, also, and really, Eretz just means land. So it says, what you say, Eretz Yisrael, it means land of Israel. The land of Israel, the West Bank is not part of Israel. The land of Israel has 20% Arabs who have been there for a long time, and although they're discriminated, just like blacks are here, they get more right to vote, more free speech than in any Arab country.
Okay, well, I think you're making a speech now.
Thanks.
This adds a lot to the discussion, but I won't want to let other people have questions. Say what they want to say. Yeah.
Well, if you want, you can go first, make sure you hand up for me.
I'm a mother of biracial children. I've got, I'm Japanese by heritage, I'm first generation. My husband is Latvian and English. And, you know, and it's been very interesting because my parents are immigrants. I've had the privilege of bringing my children to Japan and also raising them in the Chicago suburbs here. And I'm always actually struck, I was even struck growing up as a American race Japanese, how there's just this very human tendency to see the otherness in. So my children, actually, when they're with Latvians, are seen as Asians of some sort. If they know enough, they see them as Japanese. My Japanese relations see my children as white. And it's a very interesting dynamic. They're very, very, very well loved by both sides. But there's this kind of piece that says, oh, this is the uniqueness. The uniqueness tends to feature the otherness of that particular relationship. Cousins on the Latvian side was called a liar by his classmates because he told them that he had Japanese cousins, which they deemed impossible because he was white and blonde-haired. But, you know, the discussion is really interesting because having been here through the late 80s, and I studied some of the otherness under Milton Singer while I was here. You know, I've worked very hard to integrate all of that in my children and for them to see themselves as fully Japanese, fully Latvian, fully American, and not half of anything. Because I couldn't, you know, I can't say, okay, the right side of you is Japanese, the left side up to here is Latvian and the legs American. That fractional doesn't make sense. It's very mathematical and scientific, not helpful when developing a sense of self. And so for my children, I have to do something very different from what I had to do because my parents could be, oh, you're pure-blooded Japanese or whatever, which smacks of racism, drives me crazy, but is true. And in talking about sort of the discussion, how to get the dialogue going, It occurs to me that part of the reason that the otherness works with my relatives and my children is that the otherness is spoken about from the point of view of sameness. So we are the same, and this is the neat part about the difference. And, you know, I wish rather than, you know, what we're hearing, and we talked about this, the dehumanization of the enemy makes it easier to hate, easier to kill, all of those things. If instead of doing that, we could start from we're all human, you know, you just wish that the world could go that way.
Yes,
I totally agree. Another, did you have a comment?
Yeah, if we still have time. I don't know if I'd call it a comment. It's more a question for you, really, on your perspective from a different way to look at the situation. You know, there may be an unpopular opinion about racial differences, but to introduce the idea of comparative advantage, in economics, and I'm not talking about that from a birthright perspective or a, you know, regardless of source, where we came from on this earth, when we think economically, everybody has something special they can offer to society. You know, your best fit may be a professor. My best fit may be a political consultant. My brother's may be a teacher. Someone else's here may be something else. And there's a fine line between where we consider something to be advantageous and okay to recognize that difference and where we don't. When you parallel this over to the idea of race, is it fair to say that someone from Kenya is going to win a marathon every year? does that make you a racist to make that association, when in reality that's happened quite a bit, probably for the last 50 years? You know, are they faster because of their genetics? More importantly, though, does it have anything to do with the fact that they are African-American, African, from Kenya? You know, so where's your balance between what sort of difference you'll accept as being okay and what sort of profiling you'll recognize as racist?
Right. Yeah, I think you raise an extremely important point, and this is something I think always has to be said to those who say race is nothing but a cultural or social construction. It's something more than that. It always involves bodies, looks, faces, or behaviors. In Jean-Paul Sartre's Anti-Semite and Jew, he talks about a relationship of the anti-Semite projecting an image onto the Jew, and then the Jew living inside of that image. It isn't just that the image bounces off and has no effect. But you know that if all the eyes around you are seeing you as something, then you have to deal with that. Either you have to rebel against it, or sometimes you act it out, you fulfill it. That's the cultural construction side. But there's also bodies. There are genes. We're all human, of course, but we're an incredibly diverse species. And it would be folly to completely eliminate that from the discussion. And I think that there is this long history of scientific racism. I mean, using science to justify discrimination, hatred, extermination. This was the great program of the Final Solution. The Jews were treated as vermin. They were regarded as animals, subhuman. The minute you cross that threshold and say they're nothing but animals, or they are just genetically inferior, genetically different perhaps. Some people, African Americans, have a tendency to have certain built-in things like sickle cell anemia, genes for that. There's no cultural construction is involved there. Where the cultural construction comes is, what do we as a society do with these differences? I think you point to a very important difference. It's not racist to, from a scientific perspective, note that there's a difference between men and women. But it is sexist to turn that difference into a political disadvantage, an economic disadvantage. Now that's where I think the line gets drawn. Yes? Question is, what is the relation between capital and race? That's a very loaded. Do you have an agenda behind that question you want to spell out? I think it's there are lots of different ways to come at it. One is simply to note that there is a strong correlation between poverty in this country and race. That the unemployment of black people in Detroit is over the top. I'm not a sociologist, so I can't spew out impressive statistics, but we all know that race discrimination translates into economic discrimination. Now, there are people are arguing, even from the left political perspective, that that's really the crucial thing, that we should forget about race, concentrate on economics, and not worry, and affirmative action has had its day, should get rid of affirmative action. We should simply have a universal jobs program for poor white people as well as poor black people. I have no problem with the notion of trying to give everybody have a right to health care, a right to a job, a right to a decent place to live. I think that would be democracy, that would be American democracy. I don't think, though, that it deals with the reality of racism, which I think still persists and is going to be a factor one way or another. It's a very ancient, I mean, among Marxists, it's one of the most old debates. You may remember, I think it was in Richard Wright's Native Son, there's the debate between the party organizer who says, forget about being black. We're organizing the proletariat to smash capitalism. That's the important thing. Well, I don't think we're going to smash capitalism. Capitalism may smash itself. Looks like it's doing a pretty good job right now. What will come out on the other side, we'll see. But racism, I think, isn't going to go away if everybody just has a job. It'll still be there. Yes.
I was looking at this image on the screen, and I thought of an experiment that doesn't necessarily have to be a thought experiment that you might actually want to carry out yourself and report back to your class. These barriers are set up in the same sense that on a certain day after 9/11, I can no longer board a plane easily. The 10th of September, I could walk on planes. We all did. We ran to the gate, mumbled something, got on the plane. Now I take my shoes off, my jacket off, keys, I blew on. Bag with lotion for under 3 ounces, as you do, we all do. So here's the thought experiment. Since those gates were set up to protect us from the people who are going to blow up the planes, and as these barriers are, you go with a companion on a flight and let the companion get on the plane with the little bag with the 12 bottles, 3 ounces, but you don't. And then when the TSA officer comes over and says, why do you have your bottles, not 3 ounces, say, let me see your ID. And then let's see if the response is based on racism.
Yeah, I think it doesn't matter. You would be, they would say, here's my ID, motherfucker. Now, you would be in big trouble. You don't mess around with transportation security agency. It's, yeah. But I don't quite see the experiment here. What I think, here's another thought experiment to do with the TSA example. We all go through the experience you've just described every time we get on a plane. But how often do you fly?
Frequently?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
So do I. I fly, once or twice a month. Some of you maybe less. What if it were every day? What if it were in order to go to the grocery store? What if it were, if you were a farmer, and it was to go to your fields, or to go to your job, or to go to school? And I mean every single day of your life. That's, I think you need to, and you had that same TSA official there. And the only, in Israel and the West Bank, it's actually, the racial profiling is probably not quite the issue, because a lot of Israelis and a lot of Palestinians look exactly alike. I mean, anti-Semitism is generalizable. They are Semites also. So from the standpoint of visual appearance, you can't tell. All you know is somebody is coming through this checkpoint. Let's see your papers. And if those papers identify you as a Palestinian, then race kicks in. It's not always visible. That's why I think one of the things we're doing with the issue of visual culture and the visibility of race is also looking at questions like invisibility. And this is why negrophobia and anti-Semitism are such an interesting contrast. Negrophobia is all about physical, visible signs of Africanness, skin color, hair. Anti-Semitism, as Sartre points out, is about much more oriented toward invisible characteristics or toward physiognomy, not color, but shape, and also behavior. The stereotype about blacks is they're not intellectual enough, and the stereotype about Jews is they are too intellectual, which makes for a nice middle place for normative whiteness to declare itself. You know, we are rooted in the soil, we are physical, and we also have practical intelligence. It's a very comforting thing to have negrophobia and anti-Semitism on each hand to project these two others. So the structure of race prejudice often doesn't involve just one group you hate. You know, you might hate two or three, because all three of those forms of hatred then help you constitute yourself as a norm, as
you know, as Sartre puts it, the true Frenchman, as opposed to these aliens, these Jews. Yes. Yes. That's a big question. I think you point out correctly that the internet has created a new environment. That's part of why we're dealing with the mediation of race and racial prejudice. It creates a new kind of echo chamber, as you point out, reinforcement for racist attitudes. Most of the images I showed you, the prejudicial images of Obama, come from the internet, where things can, poison can be put into circulation. But I think it looks to me like we're out of time. I would like to.